Yes, I was an electronics engineer for many years working with a multinational called AIWA, where we had our main factory in Baroda, and we were like a big manufacturing unit. We were making about 10,000 TVs, about 7,000 audios per day. So it was massive production. So what happened was, like in 2009, 2000, sorry, in 2001, AIWA worldwide, they closed down. So at that time, I was getting a job abroad in Dubai, but I decided to pack up and come to Goa, where I started my own service center as well as a sales unit. And I had around 45 people working for me, 43 actually to be exact. I had 43 people working for me. But after some time, I got disappointed with what I was doing, and I slowly decided to go into agriculture. So I first purchased around seven. This was in 2006 or 2007 that I purchased about 7 acres of land in a taluka in Goa called Sattari. It is the taluka that borders Karnataka, Belgaum district of Karnataka. So with the 7 acres, then slowly I started purchasing property in and around that area close to my farm. And at the moment, I've got around 40 acres of land where I grow organic mangoes. I've got about 700 organic mango trees, and I've got a 25 acre cashew plantation. Plus, I had till before the pandemic, I had about 50 cows with me, milch cows, which I've reduced now to 5 because of the problem with the pandemic, with labor, with food shortages. I've reduced to 5, where I will start when this pandemic goes back. I will start again, and my cows are totally free range. They allowed movement in the full farm of mine. They move in the mango orchard, they move everywhere. They are only tied up in the night for their own safety. Otherwise, they are free throughout the day. I've got a few goats, maybe about 25, 30, and I've got a small poultry, about 25 odd birds. So, like what happened, my farming thing was going on. So there was a priest in my village by the name of Father Bismarck. I think many people in Goa might have heard about him. So he was always after me. Like in my village, which is called Santo Estevam or Saint Stephen's, we are an island in the Mandovi River. So we have got around 30 lakh square meters of paddy fields, mainly fields. This is a unique type of field that we have in Goa. They are called Kazan lands. These fields are basically reclaimed from the sea, from the salt waters by our ancestors. These are more than 1,000 year old. And they've got a very unique system of sluice gates to control the water coming in and out. And most of these fields, actually, these Kazan fields are sort of saline, you know. So, and they are mainly fit for certain varieties of rice. Like there are many local varieties of rice, but we have tried growing a variety of rice called Kurgut and Asgo, which do very well. Plus, there are a few varieties that we have managed to procure from ICAR Goa. They are called Govardhan 1, Govardhan 3, Govardhan 4, which do very well in saline conditions. So basically, what happened was Father Bismarck was always after me to start this project of starting a cultivation. What happened? My village is mainly not any more dependent on agriculture. There are most of the people are working on ships, in cruise liners, in the merchant navy. So basically, our fields have been lying fallow for the past 30, 40 plus years. And then what happens when your field, like you can see it throughout Goa, when your fields are lying fallow, what happens is like it comes in the this of and like as you know, Goa is like a it's a totally great brand, and everybody wants a piece of Goa. So the amount of land that is actually available for residents for staying is very less. The land that remains are our fields and our hills and mountains, which actually speaking are not allowed to be converted, but it is going on. It's going on blatantly. And so what, like Father Bismarck was always after me, let's start, because I was into agriculture. So unfortunately, about 5 or 6 years back, he died. In unfortunate circumstances. We don't know exactly how he died, but that's a different story. So it was around that time that I decided, like, let's start cultivating a field. More or less around that time, we got to know of some plans. Like, there is this thing going on in Goa. You must have heard about river nationalization and many things happening. So one of the rivers that is taken up for nationalization is basically is the river Mandovi, in which our island falls. So when we saw the plans, it shows that there are going to be jetties all around. Plus, they were planning a 15-20 meter road passing through the fields, through our village, through the church, past the cemetery and everything. And basically, it's just an invitation for destruction of our fields. So we basically decided, like, we love our village, and the best way, like, most of our fields are paddy fields. So we decided to grow paddy, because that's the easiest crop to grow in our fields. And so we started out, and like I call this, like, paddy, like the grains. This is actually coming from our heart. Like, these are grains of love, basically, you know. So this is how we call this paddy, this, like, our grains of love. So we started basically a cooperative farming, where everybody in our village have given approval to use their land to cultivate rice. And not only that, everybody has decided to pay a certain amount depending on the land holding that they. Most of the people hold about 1 acre of land. Basically, this is a system of land holding in Goa. It's called the Comunidad system, or a community system. Comunidad is the Portuguese word, community is the English word. So basically, everybody, there is a group of villagers. We are basically called Gaonkars, or the hand of the village. And this is called a Gaonkari system, where a group of villagers, they form a Comunidad committee, and that Comunidad committee allocates land to everyone to use to feed their families, basically. Unfortunately, what has happened now is this Gaonkari system has gone, and a tenancy system has come into Goa. So in the Gaonkari or Comunidad system, if you had not cultivated your field for 3 or 4 years, the Comunidad used to take the fields back, and it was handed over to some other person who was interested in cultivating the fields. So basically, what happened was, once, I think it was 1970, it was in the 1970s, that whoever was cultivating their field last were made into tenants. Basically, a tenant in Goa is more or less like a deemed owner. Means there's no way that if he's not cultivating the fields, you can tell him, sorry, we are taking back your land, and it's going to go back to the Comunidad. So basically, what happened was, people lost interest in cultivating. And like, if you see all over Goa, most of the fields that are being built into buildings are basically Comunidad lands, illegally transferred to whoever. And most of the buildings, they have got permissions which were made on the spot, so that they could grow. What I could say is, they could put up buildings in the fields. So, like, because of these projects coming in, we decided to start cultivating our fields. We formed a committee called the Ilhia Verde Farmers Club. Ilhia Verde basically means green island. Our island was one of the greenest islands before. I mean, we used to grow a lot of vegetables, we used to grow a lot of rice. Not 1 centimeter of our fields was not being used for agriculture. But over the past 30-40 years, due to various reasons, like, agriculture is not very economical in Goa, and like, people basically got higher paying jobs on the boats, as in the cruise liners, on in the merchant navy. And so they decided to give up their fields. Their fields are lying fallow. So basically, so we decided, like, let's get back, seeing what's going on in Goa nowadays. Everywhere fields are getting converted into non-agricultural, whatever they are doing in that. And so, like, if you come to my village of Sant Estev, we do not have even one building that has come up. Like, there's no building come up yet. So we are trying to keep our village as pristine as ever. And so one of the reasons we came up was, we created this farmers club and decided to start cultivating the fields under the name of the Ilhia Verde Farmers Club. So basically, what we do is, we pull together lots of people. Can I get the next slide, please, Dr. Dhatar? Hello? Yes. So basically, this is the top view, shot from the top of my village. That the church that you can see more or less in the center, and all around the village are the fields. Island was called Shakeche Jua. Jua is basically in Konkani, it means island, and Shake means vegetables. So we were very famous for this long seven ridge, na Sat Shiranche Bender, or the seven ridge, light green, long lady fingers. They grow about a foot in length. And most of our villagers, because of this particular thing, our villagers are nicknamed Bendekars, or people who grow lady fingers. So the next slide, please. So this is what is happening everywhere in Goa. Means fields are being converted for some other construction purposes, mainly, like, basically everybody in India wants to come to Goa. And there being no, now most of the legal places where developments were allowed are over. So basically now people have turned their attention to these fields. And so everywhere fields are being converted, and it's actually becoming a mess in Goa, total mess. Fields without any permissions, they are just being converted. And because of this, like the fields being converted, there's no place for rainwater also to nowadays actually go and settle in the field. So, and now as we know that climate change is creating havoc in most of the places in the world, and especially in my village, for the past 3 years, it's getting inundated every year. Can I get the next slide, please, doctor?
Doesn't look bright. Goa is getting screwed by the, you see everywhere there are buildings coming up. The full thing is gone. You're going to make Goa like Bombay. What's the point? No, it's not only this. Like, this is one paradise that is left. You can make beautiful bungalows over here. Anybody will buy for crores of rupees. That's something that most Goans don't have. But you ask a guy from Delhi, he'll pay 10 times the market price to buy a piece of land like this. You know what is happening everywhere? Fields are being taken over by the builders. Wherever land is available, first, if they want to claim some land for whatever project, the first thing they attack is agricultural land. So we decided to do this farming project, which we started last year. This year we have scaled it up by 2 times. Last year it was 5 lakh square meters. This year we are doing 10 lakhs. This is the way of protecting our lands. And we'll try to document this, make this a model sort of a project.
The message we want to send means we want to make agriculture as successful as possible, so that we can also educate the other villages.
Because this is such a massive project, it's not one and two families, it's about 300-500 families. As a community, we are calling this an actual community farming. We got everybody together, they paid money for this. Our people in Sandistev, in this village, still want to keep this place as it was many years back. So we decided that we'll do an organic project, we'll not use pesticides, not use fertilizer, not use any chemicals, so that we can get good food, you know. Means nowadays we are eating basically all cancer promoting foods. Like everywhere you see there are spraying, and all sprays that are actually banned abroad are still being used in India. So this is my way of protecting things. At least let me start it in my village. If I can show it can be done in my village, maybe the other village will replicate what I'm doing over here. Like seeing Goa, like, you know what, people in Goa don't appreciate what they see. I've been born and brought up in Bombay. You don't see this greenery. So when I see up, and if you're looking from up, you can see that it's being destroyed. You know, you can see all these monstrous buildings coming up. For what? I don't know. And people think they're coming, they want a piece of Goa. They don't know they're destroying a piece of Goa when they're coming to Goa. Goa is God's land. And the way it is going on, it's becoming like another Bombay, which is really sad and bad. Maybe what our grandchildren, great-grandchildren should be able to see what we have seen in Goa, which is actually disappearing at a pretty alarming rate. This effort is going to cost us about 40 lakhs. I don't think we've even managed to cover half the amount now, but we'll manage somehow. So it is not impossible, it is possible. You require a little will, and I say, like, if there's will, there's a way to do it.
So basically what we did was, like, we put all the youth in at work, and we managed to get all the documents, land documents. Basically in Goa, the land document is Form 114. We have reached such a state in our village that people do not even know where their fields are because it's not been cultivated for 30 to 40 years. But somehow we managed to find out about 60-70% of the owners of the land, took their permissions, and we started this. And so what happens is, like, if you see in Goa, if you ask anybody, it costs about 8 to 9 rupees even after getting all the government subsidies to cultivate 1 square meter of land for paddy. But since we did such a big project, we got the economies of scale into work, and it just cost us 3.50 rupees per square meter. Means we reduced it by more than half. So that's why it becomes much effective. Otherwise, at 8 to 9 rupees, and after that, if you don't use the government subsidies, it works out to even 12 rupees a square meter, which is not worth it. Because one thing is, in Kazan lands, we do not get more than the lands being saline, we do not get more than 200 to 300 grams per square meter of paddy, which at the present rate, like if you sell it to a trader, an authorized trader in Goa, we get at the most 20 rupees. So 300 grams works out to 6.50 rupees to 7 rupees a square meter, which doesn't, if you are doing it as in a normal way, it will not even cover the cost of your cultivation. So doing this community farming, like you can see, these are all youth and people from the village who have actually helped out. What you can see in the background is the nursery, because we are doing a mechanized project. To a large extent, we did a mechanized project. So these are these trays, seedling trays that were made and then kept for becoming big. So around after 20 days, they are planted. And then after that, it's planted through machines. Like in the video, you must have seen those seedling trays also were prepared by machinery. So most of the work that was being done through machines. So because of that, and because of the economies of scale, it was worth doing it that way. And doing a big project, you reduce your cost. Can I get the next slide, please, sir? So on the left hand side in the white shirt is a Jesuit priest by the name of Father George. He's a pioneer in mechanical cultivation in Goa. He's one of the, I could call him the savior of Goa's fields or whatever, because he's the guy who has pioneered mechanical cultivation, and he does it on a large scale. So basically, we roped in Father George for this project. In Goa, luckily, the Goa government has got a lot of schemes. We have got a system over here where if you have the field, you can get your tractors from the government department. You can get your machinery. Like Father George is something called a service provider. So he provides service of paddy transplanting. There are service providers who provide service for plowing. There are service providers who provide service for harvesting. So basically, Father George was involved in transplanting of our fields. So like the person driving the transplanters is Mr. Ashwin Varela. He's one of the youth. He was very, very much involved in the project. So basically, this is one of our ways that where we get to at least try to save our land. I'm not saying we are winning, but we are not giving up without a fight. So this was my way of doing it, and my way of trying to save at least my village. I believe in, like, charity begins at home. Though I was not brought up in that village, my parents, my grandparents, my great grandparents are from that village, that particular village, and my heart is in that village. So basically, so I decided to let charity begin at home, and I decided to do this project in Santisdev. Next slide, please. Can I get the next slide, sir?
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you. I get the next slide?
Sorry, we have only 1 minute left in this session. I think
Yeah, okay, no problem. We'll do it. We'll finish it. We'll skip to the last two,
so five. We don't have to. Something. We can join anyway in the next session and continue for the rest of the slide.
Okay, done.
Let's take a break now, because it's going to cut in 40 seconds.
Okay. For how long will the break be?
10 minutes. And then everybody please join with the same link that was sent earlier.
Okay, done. Thank you. like what, so can I get the next slide, please?
Sure.
So we cultivated in the first season, we cultivated 5 lakh square meters of land, and we got approximately, we got about 150 grams per square meter. We got about 75,000 kgs of paddy. Now the thing was, like we more than broke even in the first year. And I think everybody who had invested, like each landowner, like supposing I got 1,000 square meters of land, I put in 3,500 rupees. So every landowner got, by the month of December, every landowner got about 14% dividend. Plus whatever money remained behind, like we have this Khazan lands have got certain things called sluice gates and bunds, and to prevent the salt water and to control the salt water from the estuarine river, estuarine water bodies coming into the fields. So we even got those repaired. Because what happens if those sluice gates break down, it's a sort of a dam. If those break down, it will inundate the full fields and all the saline water will start coming in and the fields will not be usable for at least 2 or 3 years. So from the first year onwards only we got 175. What happened was, like, you know, the main problem, because we had not used the fields for so many years, there was a very huge problem of weeds. So to tackle that problem, there are two ways of doing it. One thing, you do your de-weeding manually using cono weeders or using people to de-weed or using some de-weeding machinery, or the easier way, which many people use throughout the country, is to spray a de-weeder. Basically, that de-weeder is a chemical, and you get rice specific, like you get corn specific de-weeding chemicals. So there are rice specific de-weeding chemicals that can be used, which will kill only the weeds of rice, but will not kill the rice paddy. Will not kill the rice seedlings. The problem with these de-weeders is, these weedicides, is that they are highly toxic. And if you see, you take a look around our village, like the fields are full of different types of flora and fauna. The biodiversity is amazing. Like I'm talking about the fauna, like there are snails, there are earthworms, there are snakes, there is fish, there are crocodiles. All over our village, round the village, means not, they don't enter the fields as such, but they are in the water surrounding our village. So if we use this weedicide, so it definitely affects the flora and the fauna of that particular place. So as a conscious decision, we decided not to use weedicides. So basically what we did was, like, my farm area is a place called Sattari. So in Sattari, the main crop that people get busy in is cashew. So cashew gets over by the month of May. After that, people sit idle. So what we did, sir, can I see the next slide, please? Okay, this is fine. No, but anyway, I'll continue. So what we did was, like, I got about 20 to 25 ladies from there. In Goa, we call them Kameris. So we got 20 to 25 ladies from close to my farm area. I was, my worker himself used to transport them up and down every day, because the labor over there is quite experienced and they are good. So basically I got them from there. We used to transport them up and down every day. And we, till the time of Ganesh, they work till Ganesh. After that, they are involved in setting up their Ganpati, Matos and everything at home. So till the time of Ganesh, it was about 2.5 to 3 months. And each of these ladies made about 30 to 40,000 rupees. So basically they were involved in de-weeding. We spent about 4 to 5 lakhs only on de-weeding. But I think it was well spent, because people from the village, those ladies, they would have been sitting idle. They managed to get a decent amount of money, in which I'm very sure their Ganesh Chaturthi festival went on better than if they were sitting at home, not earning anything. So basically the first year we managed to do 5 lakh square meters. The next year we did 10 lakh square meters. And like, this is one of the biggest, I won't say the biggest, one of the biggest areas of land that has been taken up in Goa. basically fallow land. Fallow land means this land was not cultivated for more than 40 to 50 years. The next slide, please.
या दिसांनी लोक खूप उलयतात की वातावरणात खूप बदल जाता. वॉट इज मीन बाय क्लायमेट चेंज? वातावरणात बदल कित्याक जाता? जेन्ना पावस जाय तेन्ना गरमी जाता, आनी जेन्ना गरमी जाय तेन्ना पावस पडटा. आयज तारीख कितली? आयज तारीख 22 नोव्हेंबर, आनी 2 दीस पयलीच पावस पडला. म्हाज्या जिवनांत अशें हे केन्नाच जावंक ना, हे फर्स्ट टायम जाला. आनी अशें जायत जाल्यार आमची पृथ्वी खूब त्रासान जातली, पडटली. लायक दर्याचे उदक वयर येतले, जनावरां मरतली, डिजीज स्प्रेड जातले. आनी हेचो चडांत चड आयज मेरेन त्रास जाता तो शेतकारांक जाता. आनी हेचें उदाहरण म्हटल्यार नॅस्टर रँजेल हो एक सांतिस्तेव गांवांतलो फार्मर. तेचें कितें जालें तें फुडें पळोवया.
These are our village fields which have been inundated with water
for about 15 days, and then what happened was much of it rotted away, so we lost most of the crop. And we were expecting a total crop of over 5 lakh kgs, but I think we might get only about 50,000 kgs at the most this season. Farming is not a short term thing, you know. There are a lot of this, and now with this climate change thing, you're not sure. So what I'm trying to tell people is, you all want to do is, please get your land insured somehow. There are some government schemes. We are going to do that next year. Get your lands insured. Fine, we lost a lot, but it goes on.
Last year we had cultivated around 5 lakhs. So this year we went around 8 to 10 lakhs. But unfortunately, in the middle, the floods came and like most of the crop was destroyed. We are getting very scarce output and produce. We are at least trying to make some money out of it. We try our best to get what we can get out of it.
So anyway, we are trying our best to do whatever we can. So this year, due to the COVID-19 pandemic, our village was quite badly affected. We decided not to do the project, but we'll be continuing next year. But in this year, I have worked in about 3 or 4 villages where they have taken up not such huge quantities of land, but little smaller, about 1,50,000 square meters. And we are continuing, and lots of villages are showing interest in getting into the way we are doing, because it reduces the rate of cultivation. So basically, I think this is a very good socio-economic model of sustainable farming. Definitely, it is going to stop concretization of land if your land can this. And basically, this is one of the ways that we preserve the character and traditions of our Goan villages. So our aim was not so much to make money, but more just to preserve our lands and keep it for our future generation, so that they can see at least what Goa was or what Goa still is. So that's basically the larger cause of our. It's nothing to do with money. Money, if you do good work, money will somehow come. So basically, that's it. Next slide, please. This was the person I was telling you, Father Bismarck. He was very much involved in environmental activism. He fought, basically, he gave up his life for this cause. So he was fighting day and night. He was in fact excommunicated from the Catholic Church because he fought against the priest of that, because he fought against the hierarchy of whatever priests that are there in Goa. And so he was basically my inspiration to do this. He was a very good friend of mine. We used to meet nearly once a month at my farm and nearly every 2 or 3 days in our village. So basically, he was my inspiration that I do this project. And he was just fighting to save our land. There was no monetary interest in this. Like if you can see on the left hand side, these are the sluice gates that allow in water to come inside and we can haul the water going out. So basically, our Khazan lands, which are the majority of fields in Goa, Khazan lands, and these help to sustain our lands. And hopefully, the government is working on these lands that we'll be able to sustain our Khazan lands for future generations. So, like these lands, their fields help to store your groundwater, underground, subterranean storage of groundwater. The excess runoff, if you don't have these lands which are below sea level, your villages will get flooded. And it is happening nowadays. Like every year there are floods, three to four days. Definitely the floods inundate our fields. Even this year, the water had come above the sluice gates. Water was flowing over the bunds. But luckily it was only for 3 or 4 days. Next, sir. Basically, this slide is self-explanatory. So we are trying now. See, basically, Goa's traditional variety is not actually Jyoti, but Jyoti is a brown variety of rice which is very widespread. But from next season, I am trying to grow our local varieties called Korgut and Asgo, which can grow in highly saline soils. So basically, with the help of Dr. Manohar from ICAR, we are trying to grow this rice. And in fact, I don't know if you can believe it or not, we do not polish this rice. We parboil it. We do not polish this rice. And each kilo sells at 150 rupees and it gets sold out within no time. So basically, we can tell farmers that if you start growing the traditional varieties of rice like Korgut, Asgo, which are basically doing well in salt water, and if they can still grow this, and then if we can provide farmers with a higher income, where nowadays when they sell their paddy, they hardly get 20 rupees per kg. Like if we can give them more, and if we can process their rice and sell the rice for a higher price, in fact, this rice is so healthy, even people with diabetes have told me that their sugar levels have dropped after eating this particular type of rice, parboiled unpolished rice. It is very highly nutritious. Most of the brand, like whatever rice we get nowadays, which is why it is totally polished, it has got no nutritional value at all. All the oils, all the minerals are just polished stuff, and that goes for making animal feed. Your rice bran oil comes from that. And whatever paint, as you call that, or the oil cake that remains, that goes into making animal feed. So basically, if you don't polish the rice, we get to eat this proper rice, which has got a lot of fiber, you can just Google brown rice, and it got a huge amount of, lot of minerals, lot of good things in it, highly nutritious. So basically, my next aim next season is to get lot of rice, lot of fields under our local varieties of rice. We have got over 25 varieties of local rice. So basically, at least I'll try to grow at least 5 or 10 varieties of rice next season in different villages of Goa. So that's our aim, to get our local varieties of rice back into the fields and into people's plates. Next, sir. So basically, this is one of the ways that we promise our people, like if our fields remain, if they are not going to be converted into residential areas, then definitely we will be getting clean air, clean water, healthy food, and hopefully we can do our best, and a lot of people are taking after this, and I'm very confident that we'll be able to keep Goa as it is now for our next generations to see. Next, sir. So that bottom number is my number. If anybody is interested, I provide free consultancy. I do not charge. I'm most willing to help out to give you all an idea how to do up your fields. So that's just my presentation. I had many more, but this is one of the main presentation that I show. So do support our farmers in Goa. You can keep in touch with me on this, either on the email ID that I've given, or you can WhatsApp me on that number down, and I'm most willing to help anybody out. Thank you. This is our slide. I think Dr. Datar, we are open for questions and answers.
Hello.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir.
Nestor, this is Ezi Gracias from Margao.
Yes, ma'am.
And first of all, congratulations. You have really done your bit to save our beautiful Goa and the beautiful island of Santishteva.
Yes, ma'am.
In fact, what I wanted to say to you is, since you are not born and bred up in Goa, your surname is pronounced as Rangel.
Rangel, yes, ma'am. But actually in Bombay, Rangel. We pronounce it as Rangel.
Okay. Yes.
In Goa, but in Goa, I pronounce it as Rangel.
Rangel.
Okay. Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Now the thing is, unfortunately, I could not go through your whole thing because of these frequent power failures we have in Goa. So in the midst of your presentation, we had a power failure here. So I missed quite a lot of it. And we do miss Father Bismarck very much because he's instrumental in saving this land of ours. And we would need your expertise, you know, since you're already into this. We have places in Margao.
Yes, ma'am.
Where I'm also thinking that we should get everybody together and start cultivating just the way you're doing.
Yes.
I wanted to know also regarding that red rice that you had just shown.
Yes.
Because I bought something similar to that from farmers in Kurtori.
Right.
But they told me that, in fact, they have to take it to some mill in Kudal.
Kudal. Yes.
But we don't have those mills here in Goa.
No, but actually, ma'am, can I answer you? Have you finished your question?
Yeah, that's it. You can tell
okay,
me.
Okay, now, you are most welcome to call me. My number was given down over there. And I think Dr. Dattar is saying this is being recorded on YouTube also.
I have you on that Sahaba, then I'm a member.
Yes, okay, fine. So this has also been recorded on YouTube, so you'll be able to get it from there.
Okay,
and regarding this brown rice, I wherever I help out in which village, I buy paddy from the farmers. After they take paddy for themselves as much as they want. Okay. After that, I buy paddy from the farmers, paying 10 rupees more than what the government will give them.
Okay.
I process that rice and there is a sale point in Margao also where we polish where we sell this particular unpolished ukda tandul, the unpolished brown rice. So basically you are asking in Kurtori, like Kurtori, what they do is Kurtori is a grain producing this for a long time village.
Yes. Yes.
I've been trying to tell the Kurtori people they are using a lot of chemicals.
Oh, I see. Okay.
Like there are a lot of urea, a lot of this. And if I'm not mistaken, a lot of people are using even weedicides.
Mm-hmm.
So wherever I work is my first requirement is that we work without any chemicals.
That's right. That's what we are looking out for.
We are working without chemicals. Maybe your produce will reduce, but definitely you're going to be eating healthier.
Yep.
And the second thing about why even I process my rice. In Kudal, the factory that has got a very modern rice mill.
Okay.
Once it is loaded in the machine, it is not touched till the bags are packed. And it has even got sorting machines and their polishing machines are top quality, where you can polish to the amount that you want or you can leave it totally unpolished also.
Okay.
Means you can control every stage. And not only that, you can sort out the rice as per the color.
Okay.
So means you can remove all the black rice, you can remove the white grains, you can sort out as per the color. So that's the reason why it was taken to Kudal. Please.
Yeah, there are two seasons in India. One is Kharif and one is Rabi. That is
Rabi. Yes.
Monsoon and other than monsoon.
Yes.
That is
yes,
dry season. So this year you lost very much because of unpredictable monsoon.
Yes, sir.
So why don't you go for dry season? That is 100% because...
So I'll tell you one thing. One thing about... Yes, sir. Can you... do you have any more questions, sir?
No.
Okay. So these fields that we got are Kazan fields. We do not have fresh water source over here.
Okay.
So basically...
But you don't have any procedure for water harvesting.
We have not started any water harvesting project yet. But maybe that's in the later stages. At the moment, we have not started any water harvesting. But if you go to Kurtori, they have got these 7 or 8, they have got these ponds, you know, that they have made. So what happens? They harvest the rainwater and that. So after one crop,
correct.
After one crop, they release that water and they take a second crop.
Question is, what you are doing with after removing the husk, what you call paddy, that is straw. What you are doing with that paddy straw after extracting the...
Actually, I'll tell you, sir, what happens is this paddy straw, no, it like I got animals at the farm. If you do soil treatment or urea treatment, you know, paddy straw, like people are buying from outside the state at 4 rupees or 5 rupees a kilo. So this paddy straw goes for 4 rupees, 5 rupees a kilo. And nowadays, a lot of this paddy straw is being used for mushroom cultivation.
Okay. So you're using, not burning.
No. We do not burn, sir. This is a very valuable commodity. We never burn it.
Correct.
It is collected and then it goes either goes as animal feed or it goes for mushroom cultivation, but mainly as animal feed. I use it for my animals.
So let me ask you a question before somebody
Yes.
question. How much of this is feasible outside Goa, where you people, if they have fallow land, how much of your consultancy is available? Would you have time for that?
No, I think this can be put into practice anywhere. See, basically, sir, I'll tell you, like in my village, only 4 or 5 people took the lead. I don't know whether you get service providers outside the state.
Okay.
I'm not very sure about Maharashtra, though I have a small leased farm over there. You do get labor, but I'm not very sure about if this is feasible because here a lot of the things are subsidized. So, and you have this concept of service providers. Like there are experts in a particular, like Father George is an expert in paddy transplantation. So there are these facilities that the government provides at subsidized prices. But we could always try in a place outside Maharashtra, outside Goa, sorry.
Right.
We could always try.
Acha, I want to ask you one thing, that what will be the economical means now, since you have a huge land, using this mechanical thing is economical for you. But approximately, means what will be the area required for this mechanical this thing?
See, like, because sir, I do it in this way, you know, like how we do it is like it. If you're doing a smaller area, like you suppose you're doing 4,000 square meters. Okay, so 4,000 square meters will work out after getting a government. I'm talking about the Goa conditions. After getting the government subsidies, it will work out to 8 rupees a square meter. So basically, if you get about 300 to 350 grams per square meter, you will just break even.
Okay.
You just break even. But if you process the rice, you don't sell it as paddy. You process the paddy and make it into rice. Like I not only stop at rice, I even make poha. Round poha. So for poha, you get an even better price. I sell my poha at 100 rupees a kg. And there's a huge demand for poha also. So basically, if you make it into rice, and if you sell, if you can guarantee that it is being grown organically, there is a better market for that. So definitely, then you end up making some money from that.
Okay.
And so basically, our aim was not to make money so much as to get our lands back into cultivation.
Correct.
Achha, this community farming is it's only this is the one case, or in Goa there are others
there are
also
many places, like Kurtori does it. There are many places, like now after that it has started in Nura, Dongri, in Divar, people are doing it.
We have comunidad systems in Goa, comunidad lands.
Means it was owned by the village, community of the village.
Basically, what organic manure do you use?
Actually, frankly speaking, we have used nothing.
I see. Okay.
Absolutely nothing. What happens is the river silt, the river water comes in. No? It brings in a lot of nutrients.
That's because you all have saline waters there. But
yeah,
beside,
we have saline. Means
we don't have that.
Yeah, so basically you'll have to use something like something called rock phosphate. You can use a little bit of like for urea, you can use something like bone. Instead of urea, you can use bone meal, or you can use some leaves of a tree called Glycidia. So there are lots of things. No doubt organic cultivation is a bit costlier because the inputs are, you have to put much more of the inputs, and the inputs are not very easily available and costly in Goa.
And the outputs also won't be much.
Yeah, the outputs won't be much. But if you definitely get a premium price when selling it.
Okay. Worth trying.
I tried it out. I found it was successful in many villages. In fact, next year we are doing much bigger projects in 3-4 more villages. So hopefully things will go on.
Good.
So basically our aim is not, if we even break even and our fields are being cultivated, means my aim is more or less, Father Bismarck's goal is more or less achieved.
Absolutely. Basically our aim is not to make money, but we need to protect our.
But I tell you one thing, what happens, ma'am, is like, if you show youth money, see nowadays, like, okay, we have earned some money and we are doing it. But you have to show youth money, other they will not remain in this job. There has to be some money coming out of it. So it has to, you can't just say that it's only a heart. Even you have to see the economics of it. And from what I've seen is, it is possible to make some money out of it.
Okay.
Like I'll tell you, in Goa, we are importing 10 crores worth of rice every month. Basically white rice, which has got no nutritional value. It's just a filler in your stomach. And we have got sufficient land in Goa where we can cultivate enough of rice for Goa itself.
Dr. Dattar, we want to thank you very much also. And please do have more sessions of this type.
We will.
Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you, Izzy. Thank you for joining. And thank you everybody for attendance. We will have this back on the YouTube very soon. Appreciate it.
Yes, thank you, doctor.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for giving me a chance to talk over here.
No, it was nice to have you. Thank you.
Bye. Goodbye, everyone.